Henry leaves the throne to his son, Edward VI. While Edward VI only reigned a short time, died at the age of 16, his reign was important because while he was king, the Church of England took on a more Protestant character. It started to differentiate itself from the Roman Catholic Church in some small ways. And the initiator of this was Thomas Cranmer, who, as Archbishop of Canterbury, he was the senior bishop in the Church of England, and even today, the Archbishop of Canterbury is the symbolic head of the Anglican Communion. And Cranmer wrote the Book of Common Prayer, which is still today the service book for the Church of England. He also got rid of clerical celibacy. That is one thing that's different about the Catholic Church versus Anglican or Episcopal churches, is that priests can marry. Edward, on his deathbed, tried to ensure a Protestant succession, tried to pass the throne to his relative, the Lady Jane Grey, but as you can see by this picture, that effort was not very successful. She ended up being executed by Edward's sister, Mary I, who was the daughter of Henry VIII and Catherine of Aragon. Since Henry had no more legitimate sons, the throne passed to a daughter. And Mary restored Catholicism with the help of her husband, Philip II of Spain. Philip II of Spain was her co-regent. He was given the title King of England. This is going to matter in a bit under Elizabeth's reign. On top of being her husband, Philip II was also her first cousin once removed. If we look at this thing here, we can see that they're not on the same level on the family tree. Charles V and Mary Tudor are first cousins. Philip II and Mary Tudor are first cousins once removed. Now, this doesn't make it any more okay. This is still some pretty bad inbreeding here, but I guess all in the name of power and dynasties and all of that kind of stuff. Still kind of weird to me, but still. Mary got the name Bloody Mary, and the reason why people called her Bloody Mary is because there were about 300 or so Protestants who were, as Protestants see it, martyred during her reign. Archbishop Cranmer was one of the martyrs of the Reformation. And Cranmer's story is very interesting. It's kind of got a psychological sort of tone to it because Cranmer is arrested and he refuses to recant his Protestant beliefs. He's going to be true to himself. They put him in jail. They mistreat him. He's like, I am a Protestant. Then they decide something a little different. They get him out of his cell. They give him a hot shower, hot meal, all that kind of stuff. And they say, hey, how would you like to have your old position back? And now that he's been given the comforts of life and all of that kind of stuff, they're like, would you like to be the Archbishop of Canterbury again, or would you like to go back to that nasty, dirty cell? And he's like, where do I sign? I want to be the Archbishop of Canterbury. Well, he signs, and then they're like, ha ha, tricked you. You know, you're not going back to jail. You're going to get executed. But before you do, then you're going to give a speech telling everybody how wrong you were and all that kind of stuff. So it's a great story because Cranmer gives this speech. And while at first it sounds like he's being penitent, he says that I am so ashamed of myself because I betrayed my beliefs. But it ends up that the beliefs he was betraying were his Protestant beliefs. So he denounces Mary and he denounces the Pope as the Antichrist and an enemy of God himself. Okay, these people, these Catholics and Protestants, didn't really like each other that much. But Mary's reign was a very contentious one because of these Protestants that were being burned at the stake. Now, Thomas Cranmer, it was said, when he was burned at the stake, that he put his right hand out. They didn't just light you on fire. They put a fire around you so that you'd kind of smother to death or something like that first. But according to the story, Thomas Cranmer sticks his right hand out because that was the hand that had signed the recantation. And he said, my unworthy right hand, ow, that burns. You know, gosh, I mean, it's like, whew, you gotta really be serious to put your hand in the fire like that, right? Another reformer who wasn't on very good terms with Mary was John Knox, who was the founder of the Church of Scotland, which was a Calvinist-influenced church, and he was the father of Presbyterianism. John Knox wrote a treatise known as the First Blast of the Trumpet Against the Monstrous Regimen of Women. In 1558, he wrote that not only was this a problem with Mary, but this is just what happens when you put women in power. He wrote, "I fear not to say that the day of vengeance which shall apprehend that horrible monster Jezebel of England, and such as maintain her monstrous cruelty, is already appointed in the Council of the Eternal. I very believe that it is so nigh that she shall not reign so long in tyranny as hitherto she has done." Now, she'd been reigning about 4 years up to that point, and so he's saying she won't reign four more years. Well, she dies in 1558, less than a year after Knox publishes his treatise, which you gotta figure Knox is like, hey, what did I tell you? He gets to be right, and that's awesome to be him at the time. But the problem is that Mary's going to be succeeded by her sister, who is not really going to want to have anything to do with John Knox, who hates women who are in power and that sort of thing. And Bloody Mary, of course, lives on. Some of you, when you were little, might have gone into a dark bathroom and said Bloody Mary however many times in front of the mirror. Yeah, I guess I have no idea if that has any validity to it. Some people say it's totally real. Try it sometime, or don't. But anyway, let's move on to Elizabeth I, who restored Anglican Protestantism after Mary's five-year reign. And in 1559, Elizabeth and Parliament agreed upon what's known as the Elizabethan Religious Settlement. And this has two elements. The first off is religious uniformity. Second, a bit of a compromise or an attempted compromise with Catholics. So first of all, everybody's compelled to attend Sunday services in the Church of England. Everyone is going to be an Anglican Protestant. But at the same time, there would be several Catholic practices that would be retained. So Mary, while Henry didn't want to change really much of anything, and Edward was bringing the church more in a Protestant direction, and Mary, you know, brings it back Catholic, and Elizabeth is trying to preside over a sort of moderate Protestantism. And the Pope wasn't going to be abused in the litany. They weren't going to say bad stuff about the Pope and the service and stuff like that. So she's trying to placate people who have some Catholic sympathies. And Parliament gives her the title of Supreme Governor of the Church of England. Note, not Supreme Head. Why not? Because she's a woman. They're sexist. All right? History is full of sexist. Now, the Elizabethan religious settlement would accomplish Elizabeth's goals of having one church that everybody's attending and compromising with Catholics a little bit, but the problem's not going to be from Catholics, but on the Protestant end, that there are going to be radical Protestants over the following century that are going to resist this religious uniformity and this Anglican church that they believe is too Catholic. That's going to be a factor leading up to the English Civil War in the next century. Now, although Elizabeth tried to compromise with Catholics, the Pope certainly wasn't happy. In his bull, Regnans in Excelsis, the Pope says that Elizabeth is an illegitimate ruler and advocated her overthrow and released all Catholic subjects from any kind of loyalty to her. And Elizabeth responds by kicking the Jesuits out of her country, says, "You've got 40 days to get out of here or I'm going to kill you," basically. And then there's Philip II. Remember Philip, who was the King of England when he was married to Elizabeth's sister Mary. Philip proposed marriage to Elizabeth I. Elizabeth I's like, no. And Philip's like, come on, we're not even related. Like, that didn't stop me, but still, I mean, we're not even related. Elizabeth's like, no. Keep in mind that Elizabeth sees if she gets married, then she may have to take on a husband as co-regent. So really, in the sexist world that she lived in, it was best for her to stay single. She was known as the quote-unquote virgin queen because she never married. But Philip II's not about taking no for an answer. He wants the throne for himself. He wants the throne for Catholicism, and he's got the blessing of the Pope. So in 1588, important year, you should know 1588, this is when Philip launched the Spanish Armada, which is one of the biggest failures ever. The Armada, this is a fleet of very, very, very big ships. So the Spanish fleet of very, very, very big ships that is defeated by the Royal Navy. So Philip is unable to land an army. If he would have been able to land an army, might have been successful, but he was unable to land an army, and this was a massive failure. And so Elizabeth has won this battle with the Spanish Armada, and this really is significant because it's seen by a lot of historians as a shift in the naval balance of power away from Spain and toward England. So you have the beginning of British naval supremacy that's really going to last into the 20th century. Elizabeth dies in 1603. She reigned over 40 years, 44 to be exact, and during this time, keep in mind, Edward reigned for a short time, Mary reigned for a short time, Elizabeth reigned for a long time, and during this time, she was able to firmly establish England as a Protestant kingdom. And this is where you have this legacy, with a lot of folks on both sides and a lot of bickering back and forth, but England is going to be a Protestant country, but with a very moderate to conservative Protestant church. Not anything overboard or anything like that, but that is important that Elizabeth finally establishes England as a Protestant country. If this helped you, if you like what you heard, subscribe to my channel, visit my website. I'm on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, all that kind of stuff. Like, dislike, comment. Let me hear from you. I'll be back soon. Until next time.